Outside a newsagent's in Belfast, police investigate a bomb scare. Earlier, a customer came into the shop with a radio wrapped in a plastic bag and asked if she could leave it there while she went shopping. The shop assistant took the radio in, but she's now worried that it might be a bomb.
But she says, I'll explain it all to you when I come back.
What sort of clothes was she wearing?
I couldn't really tell you.
Well, that'll do me anyway. These other boys will be here shortly. We'll check it out with Ben. But just in the meantime, don't be worrying about it.
Something?
It's the shape of something. I'm not saying it's anything, but it's... don't you worry about it. You're all annoyed. Way up there and have a cup of tea. Just anyway for safekeeping.
In any other British city, the scare would be unthinkable. But as the killing and bombings continue in Belfast, the city's nerves begin to fray. Even leaving a radio in a shop becomes a suspicious act, a matter for the overworked police. The shop assistant has put the radio in a box in an outside lavatory. Bomb or harmless parcel? How is a shop assistant to know?
So I took the parcel, and immediately I took it, I realised I shouldn't have taken it. Of course, as I said, with me being on a week's holidays, I never thought anything of it.
You didn't think the situation was...
No, I didn't know it was really so bad.
Mm. People have told you since you've been
yes.
there. What have they said to you?
Well, they said it was terrible.
After the police, the army bomb disposal team arrives and the experts go to inspect the radio. About 4 out of 10 of these bomb scares turn out to be real. And there's another hazard. A favourite IRA tactic is to get the army to the bomb scene and then use snipers against them. The army keeps on the alert and takes no chances. The scare is over. The army say the parcel is a radio after all. Few will hear about the incident, but a little more fuel is added to the fear of Belfast. Farringdon Gardens in Belfast is the most horrifying monument to the city's fear. 219 houses in the area were burnt by their Protestant occupants as they fled the August violence. Only Catholic families are left in the street now. Since August, 10,000 people have moved home in the city as Protestants move to Protestant areas and Catholics to Catholic areas, fixing the boundaries between the two religions more firmly than ever. Claims for property damage alone in Belfast amount to £16.5 million. But the real damage is more difficult to assess. It's the damage done to ordinary people who begin to despair of the city or give up hope for it altogether. People like the Geeran and Lagan families, who live next door to each other in Farringdon Gardens and have both decided to emigrate to Australia.
I'm definitely determined to leave this country. I have no more future in it, as far as I can see, for me or my family. And, well, it's just one of those things that when you see a street burnt down around you that you've put so much into a house now that there's no use to you and nobody wants, well, there's only one thing that I can see, and is to make a new life for my family somewhere else.
You think it could happen here?
Never thought it, that it would. I tell you the truth, when I look out, I can't really believe that it has happened.
Since 1969 here, why couldn't the ordinary people, the ordinary decent people, stop all this happening?
In 1969, there wasn't really the guns on the street that there is now. And people didn't mind coming out on the street. But, like, with people shooting at one another, nobody's going to come out on the street at night. The decent people stayed in their homes, so they did.
Man to man, I stand and defend my house, but when somebody comes up and starts shooting at you, it's a wee bit different, so it is.
How has it affected your life here, in general?
General life is miserable here. There's no social life. You can't go out at night. You can't go to visit anyone. No one comes to visit you. When your door knocks, you won't let the children answer the door. You wait till an adult answers the door. You're just waiting and wondering what is going to happen. Once the dark comes, everybody closes their door and that's it.
Do you think the children here are more difficult to control now?
Well, I do. I think they see so much violence. And all children seem to want to do is to throw a stone, or now it's light a wee fire up in one of the old houses.
Yes.
You know, the children are seeing these things going on, and naturally that's what they're playing at. Where we used to play wee houses and dress up and clothes and
children
things like
don't
that.
Do this children don't do no, I find it very difficult at times. Because it's evidence, and with the eldest lad, you know, they won't definitely do as they're told.
And then
told.
There's so much rubble lying about and things like that.
The children of Belfast have got used to the extraordinary and are now being reared on it. Three times a day in term time, the British Army turn out in force just to see that Protestant pupils and Catholic pupils do not fight each other. The army realizes that clashes between school children have spilled over to the adults and started riots in the past. There's complete religious separation at school. Catholics go to church schools, Protestants to government schools. So children often leave the badges off their uniforms because it makes them a target for intimidation. Catholic children keep to the right, Protestants away to the left. The army in between. Youthful hooliganism and vandalism are as much part of the Belfast scene as the more organised violence of the extremists. Discipline is a growing problem, according to a city psychiatrist.
Discipline both at school and at home has suffered very, very badly. We have a setting in which children have defied the might of the British Army, and following this, their parents and their schoolmasters are a pretty small fry to them. And attendance is down, 50, down to about half in many schools.
So once you've in fact gone out the street and stood up to the British Army, there isn't much else that really should worry you, you mean?
There are no more worlds to conquer.
There is only one real growth industry in Belfast these days, glazing. Now there's a shortage of men to fit new windows after the daily bomb blasts in the city. The bombing campaign has affected everyone. No area of the city is now safe from the terrorist. The target in this case was a police station in the heart of the city. But office workers and shopkeepers know that terrorist bombs do not always hit their intended target. Although commercial life carries on with a blitz-type determination, no one can feel completely safe anymore. But other public employees are just as affected as they try to keep the city running. A burning bus in Belfast is now accepted like the barricade as a fact of life. When the troubles first broke out, buses were used as barricades. Now they're more likely to be hijacked and destroyed. This not only disrupts the bus services, but often lures the army into the sniper's ambush. It's a tribute to the busmen that the services still run through blacked-out streets, barricades and riots.
We have lost 30 complete burnouts, and there's been 414 other buses damaged. Bear in mind, some of them have been damaged more than once. But it's not the crowd in the street that's really a big bugbear to us, although it's bad enough. It's a man that gets on and pulls a gun and sticks it in your head and says, get off. Thursday morning, I left Falls Terminus at 5:27 a.m. and I got through. But the lad 20 minutes behind me, the gun was produced, got the bus taken off him, a bomb threw into the bus, which immobilized it, and it was left sitting there for the army to come up. And these lads were waiting on them. But the army were too bloody cute. Well, too cute, they didn't come up. 3 weeks ago, in the morning, there was a bus 5:05 out of the depot, and I was 12:12. Of course, I warned them to keep the boot down, and instead of going 7 minutes behind him, I went down right behind him. Well, a mob broke every window in his bus. And then they realized I was behind him with a bus and no ammunition left for mine, and I got through. But he had no window left, and that sort of thing happened on the 5 a.m. in the morning, and pitch black, isn't a very pleasant happening.
Why are you putting these boards up?
Well, and put the boards up to see the windows here.
Well, do you put them up, for the rest of the day or what?
No, I put them up when I'm going out for a walk. And when I come back, I take them down. I said, wear glasses and I can't see in the inside here.
How long have you been doing this?
I've been doing it for 3 weeks now.
Who does all the damage here from these?
Well, the stone thrown at the army across the way here. And I had this bottom one up here, and before I could get the other one up, the stone went through. That was a fortnight ago when there was riots in three successive nights.
And can you get the windows replaced?
No, I'm an old age pensioner, and I can't afford to replace the windows myself. £6 a week can't afford glass. That window had cost over £1 nearly replacing and all, and upstairs as well. But £2 more.
Are you going to do this every time you go for a walk? Put these
up? I must do it. I won't have any windows when I come back. You never know when these things occur.
How do you...
Can you answer me when a riot would start? I don't know. You don't know.
Who's doing all that? Who's causing all the trouble down here then?
Now, Mr. ask me another one. Who's causing it all? Who's causing it all over the city? Brave factions, one say, the other say. And the old people have got to suffer for it.
Do you think there could be any service to help old people here in this present time?
Well, I don't know what service they could do. They'd take them away to the moon or something. Peace and quietness.
Is a major stressor, not so much the experience. The people that can go out into the streets and act out their anxiety, even though they're doing something like throwing stones, seem to have thus given themselves some kind of protection. It's the people who are sitting around worrying about what might happen that get mentally ill. The same pattern was noticed in wartime.
Is it fair to compare it with a war situation and people's reaction to it?
In many ways, it's worse than the war. In wartime, well, to begin with, the enemy was somebody pretty remote. There was somebody pretty far away. There was a certain amount of physical and psychological preparation possible. For example, you heard the air raid sirens and you're timed to get clear. But here, the enemy can strike at any time, and you don't know who your friends are. They're all around you, who your enemies are.
The need for people to know their enemies and friends has led to a vast migration of families in recent weeks. The houses they left are blocked up to stop further vandalism, not to stop people taking them over. For neither Protestant nor Catholic wants to live in Bryson Street anymore. Once mixed, it's now a no-man's land. To the west of Bryson Street, the Catholics have retreated to be with their own. And to the east, Protestants have moved to houses just a few seconds' walk away. But though it's only a few seconds away, the short distance means everything to the Protestants. They have retreated to an all-Protestant road, Thistle Street. Mrs. Garnham, her husband and four children, definitely feel safer in Thistle Street.
But the point is, you're only about, 10 yards away from
that's
where you lived before.
Yes, that's true, yes.
For what? Do you feel
but
safe?
I just feel a bit safer, I do. Uh-huh.
Why?
Because I'm living among all my own kinds of religion now, you know? Just the same as what I am, like. I just feel like that wee bit safer.
Do you think, can you get used to this sort of life, Mrs. Garnham?
Well, I suppose there's nothing else for me, is there? Like, only...
Have you ever thought of leaving entirely?
No. No.
What about your husband? Has he ever thought of leaving Belfast?
Well, yes, he, at one time, he was wanting to emigrate to Australia. But I... prefer getting homesick, you know. I'm kind of a homebird, as you call it.
But does he think there's much future here? I mean,
no, definitely he doesn't. He says this is no place to bring your family up, you know.
You don't think there's any chance of people getting together again?
I don't honestly believe it, no. Don't think so, not this time, like there's not.
How's it going to end here then?
But I don't know. I often say to my husband, where's it all going to end to? And my husband will say, it's not even started yet, you know?
These soldiers coming down here now, I mean, have you got used to seeing soldiers coming through the
city? Seeing the soldiers, Yes, the children and all are used to them too, you know?
Not the sort of thing you'd see in Birmingham though, is it?
No, it scared the life out of them in Birmingham.
Have you,
it's like you think you're in the war, don't you?
Do you think it's a war that really is like a war?
It looks like a war to me.
The trouble in Belfast never looked like a war to the green and pleasant middle-class suburbs. The news may have been about the riot areas, but they were far away in the working-class centre of the city. Now, with a stepped-up bombing campaign, even the suburbs are fearful. Only last week, terrorists burnt down a £20,000 house on the outskirts of the city, and more suburbs have come under attack this week. The television news about Belfast does not seem so remote to the middle classes now. When did they begin to feel that the trouble in Belfast was actually affecting them?
In the last few months, when it's sort of started to move away from the area, say, the Falls and Ardoyne and those areas down into the centre of the city where commercial buildings are being attacked, and then even some of the other suburbs where private property is being subject to terrorist elements. Yes, I think we're all getting a wee bit concerned, and we tend, I would say, to look around. I know for myself, going into town, I look around to see in shop recesses, or any boxes or anything which could be bombs, or packages in cars. I think this is, we all do this. But I think you've only got to go into the centre of the city today to see the few people who are on the streets. And in quite a number of the big offices, I've heard of many of the girls who are looking for jobs in the country and across in England. Mm. They want to get away from the centre of Belfast.
Do you find that you're worried about what sort of place it will be for children when they grow up?
Yes, this does naturally worry one a lot. And I think particularly when you hear perhaps your own child or children say, well, there's not going to be anything here for us. We'll have to get out of Ireland. This is very sad when one is Irish born and bred. I think this is very, very sad.
Has this happened with your son?
This,
I mean, do you
yes.
find
oh,
your
yes,
son saying
yes.
this sort of thing?
Yes, we were talking about this at this tea party I was at this afternoon, and so many children are feeling this way. I'm talking now about the 12 to 16-year group, and this is how they feel.
Did you ever think, Mr. Duncan, living out here, which is a long way from the city, that you would ever be affected by the troubles?
I never thought I would have been affected. No, I thought we were completely isolated from it. And then one or two of the houses round about here were damaged. And I thought, well, listen, we're all in the target area.
What precautions do you take?
Here at home? There's very little precautions we can take. There's nothing we can really do. I mean, if gunmen come in here and hold us up and ask us to leave the house and they sprinkle petrol oil over it and set it afire, we can do very little. I mean, I don't think it's time for heroics.
But for some, the trouble has been too near for them to stand any more. The house of Edward Gunn, a Catholic in a Protestant area, bears the scars of recent trouble. Edward Gunn, his wife and three children are emigrating to New Zealand, with their house still unsold. He was leaving Belfast that night.
See, this house here is in a very, it's a good area, isn't it? I mean, you've got the playing fields and, I mean, there's plenty of open space.
There's nothing we haven't got here. Nothing. Modern fields, playing fields, bowling greens, tennis, plenty of space.
Why are you moving, Mr. Gunn?
Well, I can't stay in the situation the way it is, and boys hounding the life out of breaking the windows at night, and the protection he gets very little.
Are the army and the police helping at all?
And when I reported it the first night it happened, the soldiers were heavy committed, and I reported the police. Well, they didn't come away by Tuesday, and that was Saturday. And the boys that stoned us on Saturday night come back on Sunday night again.
So you really
And we have to do, me and a boy of 16 have to do guard on the property.
Every night?
Every night. Although, now and again we get soldiers, but they can't stay too long. Now, one night they'd only left at 20 minutes to 10. They came at 20 to 10, and they left at 10 to 10. 5 minutes after they left, the lads were down breaking the windies. And they had the whole living room down below littered in stones and glass.
When you moved here, did you worry about moving into a Protestant area?
No, indeed I didn't. I never had nothing to fear from anybody. I worked and made my own business and content to the country suited me. I've done well here, I've worked hard. Everywhere I went, I've worked 60 hours a week, winter and summer. I've been fortunate that I got to work like. People that I know that have families of their own, they know me, and most people know me that I wouldn't hurt a fly. Now, I don't want to stay here and be provoked into something.
You feel you would have to?
And get angry, because the second night it happened when they come back, I swore I'd shoot the lads if they come back to my door again, because I don't think it's fair. I pay everybody, pay my way, ask for nothing. Never ask for anything in my life. And this is what I get.
What about the house itself? You must be losing a lot of money moving, mustn't you?
Well, up to now, I haven't got anything, only for our furniture.
What about that? You must have lost money on selling that.
I know, I've lost money on furniture. I paid, as I told you, £53 or something for a bed and this room done up here.
When was
You're
that?
Starting it 3 weeks ago.
You bought new furniture just 3 weeks
ago? 3 weeks ago, and I papered the place. And I got 18 or something for it.
£18. Was this garden, is this all your work out here?
Yes, this is all my work. In fact, about 4 or 5 weeks ago, in fact, I crazy paved this here. I bought the paving. And this was my hobby. Improving on this property. This was my interest in life. To improve, to make the property better than what it was, or any improvements, I done them because I work in this.
You're in the building trade, are you?
In the building trade. I put this fence up here.
Yeah.
And we built this wee wall. The wife likes a wee bit of show of flowers. She done this part of it. Yeah. And around the back there, I've had concreted here for a lean-to.
You're going to build a shed here, will you?
In the back of it. Yeah. You know, you can see it up the other side.
You say you bought furniture only 3 weeks ago.
That's right.
Does that mean that you've made your decision in the last week or two to move?
Yes, that's right.
Has anybody asked you to stick it out?
Well, the authorities has asked us, different people, would you not try and stick it out? But to stay here and try and guard property with me, a boy of 16, against a mob, I think it's beyond the job I work at. You come home and you expect to get sitting down or having a bit of sleep or a bit of peace. And to start trying to defend property with stones and bottles. I couldn't do it.
These people who come and throw stones at you, these young people, do they know you?
Now, who would they know me? Or what did I do on them? Or what did I do on their parents?
They wouldn't know you at all?
Just because I'm a Catholic, like I'm not allowed to stand with... I'm not allowed to live here or have a house or... All of a sudden, like, you don't want, you get out.
Do you have any regrets?
Like, I was born here, like, and my wife is born here, and my children's all born here, with no political...
You've been happy up to now here?
We've had a good life here. I couldn't have wished for better. And my job, and on the building, I couldn't have done any better. I couldn't have done any better. And any employer I worked for, they trusted me to work. They didn't have to stand over me. I got jobs quite easy, in fact. Because when I was asked to do anything, I done it.
Have you any regrets about leaving? I mean, you're now going tonight. You're leaving for good?
Well, not really. The boys, whoever they are, they've scared the wits out of me and out of my family.
Why do you want to go to New Zealand?
Well, as far as I know, even the people out there now have been assured by my brother-in-law.
You got a brother-in-law there?
Yes, he's there 13 years. Good life, good social life. Everybody mixes. nobody's into it. All they're interested in the same as me, improving their property or having a weekend away down to the seashore. And generally enjoying themselves. But they get involved in people's religion or who you are, what you are. I never got this house or anything I've ever got to work for it. And religion didn't get me it. And I don't intend to stay here and fight about people about religion either. I don't want no part of it.
You think you'd ever see Belfast again?
Well, I would rather not. I think I'll cut my losses and clear out.
These are some of the things that happened in Belfast yesterday. A machine gun attack on the army in Herbert Street. A crowd dispersed by troops in the Ardoyne. An explosion in a bar at Louisa Street. One soldier shot in Butler Street. An explosion in Divis Street. A bazooka attack on the army in Leonardon Avenue. A bar blown up in the Shankill Road, wounding 27 people and killing two. It was an average day in Belfast.